Awesome. So welcome all for the webinar. And today I'll be talking about machine learning on Kubernetes. So machine learning is complex and Kubernetes is not easy. So when they both come together, it's super hard. So you have to be super technical, you know, awesome in machine learning and awesome in Kubernetes to understand this talk. Don't believe me. I'll make this talk as simple as possible. So I'm working as Director of Technical Evangelism at Civo, and let's get started. So we'll go. Today we'll be covering what is ML, ML challenges, ML on Kubernetes, Kubeflow, and a small demo, not that much, but I just want to show the UI. So machine learning. Machine learning is everywhere. So from your day-to-day activities to whatever you do, whatever you order, whatever you listen, machine learning is everywhere. So you take Spotify, you get predictions of the songs, your favorite songs from all around the artists, and you book Uber, you get the nearest rider, you book Airbnb, you give a rating. Next time when you come, you'll get recommended, recommended listings from the other users who rated the same one. So like this, there are other predictions that are doing. You go to shopping online, you buy some product, and when other people have bought the same product and whatever they have purchased, so you will be shown that as listing on your screen. And obviously it's not that easy. So they have additional complex algorithms and ML models that they have developed so that you get very curated list of your recommendation. So also when you order food, so basically ML is at all levels. So you take any day-to-day activities, any organizations, people are doing ML, they want predictions, they want recommendation systems. So everything is there. So what is ML? What is machine learning? So basically, the first thing over here is human teach human. So think of a baby, and we teach a baby how to walk, and then they develop a skill. We teach them how to ride a bike, and then they develop a skill. So basically, we are training them, and they are developing a skill. So the similar kind of approach is used when we talk about machine learning. So humans, basically now what we do is we create a model. So we have a training data. So we use that particular data, make it very insightful, and a lot goes into that particular aspect, the data aspect. That is the main one. And then we create a model, and we do predictions. And then we learn more. We try to train it more with the test data for the accuracy and all the other stuff. And the end goal is that it itself, our application or the end goal, will develop a skill. So basically what you call AI. So AI is skill, like learning, machine learning on its own. So that's the end goal of any ML pipeline or any ML process. So basically this is how, in short, I feel from data, making it valuable and converting it to a skill is all about machine learning. So you have training data and another insight of that. So training data, so you do the training, you create a model. So model is just the code that you write and the algorithms that you use to generate some insightful results from the data that you have. And then you have the output, and then based on that output, you do the predictions. So very simple example, you can have a simple application where you upload a picture and it'll tell you which animal it is. So like this, it's everywhere. And now ML, like I told you, it's not simple and it has its own complexity. So this is one of the diagrams from the Google research paper. So the ML code that you can see in the middle is this much. And you can see what all things has to be a part of a full machine learning workflow or pipeline or whatever you can call it, a ecosystem. So you have the configuration, you have data collection, data validation, tagging, classification, all these things. And then on the infra side, you have your machine learning resource management, analytics tools, the infrastructure, and then the monitoring on top of it. So there are a lot of aspects when we talk about machine learning as a whole. And there's a very small piece over there, which is the ML code that a machine learning engineer will, people will say that, okay, he's developing models. But no, there's a lot of other things that has to be done in order to implement that model and make it work and serve it in production. So you have different languages, and machine learning has evolved over time. So it's not like the frameworks have evolved. There are different frameworks to choose from. The languages have evolved, different languages to choose from. There are devices that you can run, CPUs, GPUs, TPUs, Edge, on-prem, all these things. So you have R, Python, Scala, and you can, PyTorch, scikit-learn, TensorFlow, like I told you, all the devices that you can make use of doing this ML processing, training, serving, and all these things. So now what happens is we should, why Kubernetes? So why machine learning on Kubernetes? So we all know, and if you don't know, I'll just brief you about it. So containerization, eases out the process of, application dependencies and everything packaged inside single code. You can use different binaries, different versions of an application and all those. So that's containerization stuff that you can do. And Kubernetes is an orchestrator and it's having its own set of powerful features. Now, when we talk about ML on Kubernetes, we say that there are basic things that we are looking for, which is composability, portability, and scalability. You must have heard this if you have watched any of the Kubeflow talks. So composability is basically you have the microservices and microservices integrate very well when you talk about the Kubernetes ecosystem. It's extremely portable because you have the base layer already ready. And you will be able to switch your workload from on-premise to cloud or to from your laptop as well, very easily. And then scalability, yes, Kubernetes, have scaling capabilities. And whenever you are writing a model and then your training data increases and your model goes into production, then there is a scale that is required. And Kubernetes can handle that very well. And other things like related itself. So auto scaling, resource control, multiple tools, like you have monitoring, logging, you can use service mesh. So all these things takes the advantage. So these are the Kubernetes advantages. So machine learning will be able to use all these advantages very well. Now you have machine learning. Now you have the ecosystem. Now you have the base layer, the compute layer, all set with the Kubernetes in place. So, okay, I have Kubernetes in place. Now what do I do? Now, there are a lot of things apart from it when you talk about ML workflow, when you have to develop, deploy, and manage the model. And that's where Kubeflow comes in. So Kubeflow is something that is built on top of Kubernetes. So anywhere that you can run Kubernetes, you can run Kubeflow. So you have a base layer of Kubernetes, and you have the Kubeflow layer on top of it, which is containerization machine learning ecosystem. So you have everything containerized. It's a containerizing machine learning platform that helps you to develop, deploy, and manage your complete machine learning lifecycle. So there are different aspects to it. You have data validation, you have evaluation, you have model training, you have model serving, you can do all. So it provides you a complete package to do all the machine learning tasks that you need. And it gives you a concise, it gives you all the frameworks and everything that will go the next. So this is what it looks like. It's based on operators. So like kubectl is the command when you run all the kubectl things on interacting with the Kubernetes. There's a similar binary called kfctl that you will be using when you want to install Kubeflow on Kubernetes. So with kfctl, you can provide configuration files where you can actually tell whether you want to use PyTorch, whether you want to use TensorFlow. So all these things, so everything is configurable and whatever you need to choose, you can configure that and Kubeflow will be a ready package. So you can have a PyTorch serving, TensorFlow serving, Silden core, and you can, Dockerize it, Dockerize your machine learning workloads. And most importantly, you have a UI. You have Jupyter Notebook integration, which is very good. So because you don't need your laptop anymore, I would believe, if you are just doing very big training. So you will be just having Kubeflow installed on any cloud, on Kubernetes infrastructure, which has a huge scale of CPU and GPUs attached to it. And then you will be running your Jupyter Notebook. So it's powered by Jupyter Lab. So your Jupyter Notebooks will be there and you can share it across the teams. You can have different workspaces. So all these things will be there. So you can, write the code, your model over there and test out all the training data from the storages. So storage is also another aspect that, Kubernetes can take use of with respect to different cloud vendors. And it's platform agnostic. You can run it on any of the cloud platform. And then you have Kubernetes and then you have the all the ML tools. So it gives you the extensibility and the power to use any of the ML tools that, any of the ML tools. So you can use any of this like they are mentioned over here. Now, apart from this, you can take the Kubernetes capabilities, which are Prometheus, Argo, Istio. So all these capabilities obviously comes with Kubernetes. So you can use those capabilities as well. So before this, I would like to show a demo as well, which is, I hope it works. So basically, I have already deployed Kubeflow on a Civo managed KTS cluster. So this is a whole Kubeflow running. Though the thing is, like, when you deploy Kubeflow, you actually have to deploy a YAML file and do some configurations, and it's very important that you understand that. Else, it will not deploy properly. Though you will be running some aspects will be running, because you know it exposes as a service, and you get your Istio ingress. So some aspects will be working, but if you do not specify the right parameters, and it won't be a full-fledged working. So make sure you do that, and you can check out all on the documentation. So this is how the Kubeflow UI looks like. You have homepage. Pipelines, I'll not touch, because pipelines are something you will hear about more in the next talk. Kubeflow pipelines. So notebook servers, which is very interesting. So this is what I was talking about. You can have a new server, and you can, you know, name it test, and you can choose image already. So there are pre-baked images. You can bring your own image of different flavors, and you can specify the CPU, and you can specify the workspace, add volumes, and also shared memory in GPUs if you want to add. So, and you can click on launch. So behind the scenes, it's actually creating a pod, which you will be seeing over here, and then you can connect to this particular pod, and it will basically open a Jupyter notebook. So it's running, and no healthy upstream. So we'll wait, maybe. Yeah, so this is the Jupyter notebook, and I have it. I can, you know, create the file. You can see all the things over here, which is very good. Also, Kubeflow, let me go back to the home. There's cattips, which is there for hyperparameter tuning. Now, when you create a machine learning model, you have to, define the accuracy. You have to have the hyperparameter tuning so that you can define certain parameters, and you have to identify that. Then you can predict the what you call the accuracy, so that you can see how much accurate the model is. And cattip is there to help you on that. So you define what all the parameters are that I want to, tune my model to, and then you can also increase the accuracy of that. So all in all, this is the high level overview of machine learning, why machine learning on Kubernetes, and what Kubeflow is and how it looks like. With this, I think I'm done for this particular talk. So any questions, just let me know in the chat, and with that, I'll hand over to you, Andy.